Hey guys, this is David Kwong. So every Sunday, I try to make a video about philosophy, things related to religion, gods, atheism, my humanism, about morality, and things of that nature. I wasn't able to do it last Sunday because I was sick, but I will continue today, actually. So today, I want to continue on the thought of the implications of God or Godhood. But take it in a much different light than last time's. Because last time I talked about, well, what if God or gods or godlike beings existed? And I tried to kind of personally explore the implications of that, or the ramifications actually, because it's just not a positive thing to me. If a god exists, as I said in that video, it means, you know, whether it's a multiple gods or whether it's Zeus, Ares, Athena, or whether it's Superman or Wonder Woman, or whether it's actually Yahweh, the God of Abraham, the implications, it's pretty simple to me. It means that there is a being that is so much more powerful than me. Much, much more powerful, that it can do whatever it wants and I would have no power to resist it. If this God told me to kill a gay person because this God thinks homosexuality is a crime or a sin in his eyes, he tells me to do it, I mean, how can I refuse, right? I would like to refuse, but then this God is so powerful that he will just strike me down with lightning and kill me. This God can coerce me to doing whatever he wants me to do. That's the implications of a God, right? If a God exists, his morality becomes my morality, even if my moral compass goes against his morality. It doesn't matter. Well, it does matter, but I am powerless. My resistance is futile. That was pretty much the gist of everything that I've said in the last video. I feel like that one was scripted. I wrote down what I wanted to say on my iPhone, actually. I couldn't sleep. I had insomnia, so I just started typing my thoughts on what if gods existed, and then that's what became that video. Today, I want to kind of twist that concept. So that's what I think if God existed, but what if we became gods? So that's a weird thing, because godhood is not the same here. Well, maybe if we can compare ourselves, if there's this analogy where, like an ant, you know, an ant and us. To an ant, we are like godlike beings. We're able to do to the ant whatever we want to do with it. And the ant is powerless to us, you know? But that's not the route I want to go. Being a god means kind of being able to create and controlling that creation, right? Being able to do whatever with your creation. But I think in our main discourse about godhood, there's a lot of things that are involved with godhood, such as omnipotence, omniscience, the all-knowing part of thing, all-knowing, all-powerful, and everywhere. Every which place, you know, with outside of time and space, that's certainly a concept of godhood. But there's only one concept that I want to focus on in this video, because certainly we human beings can't be that. We human beings cannot be all-powerful. We cannot be all-knowing, maybe debatable, maybe, kind of, but really, generally speaking, we can't be all-knowing, and we definitely can't be omniscient, we can't be everywhere, or is that the right word? I don't know, but we can't be everywhere all at one time. We exist, we occupy one single space, and one single time. We don't go outside of time and space. That's not who we are. So, we can't be a god in the sense that Yahweh is considered to be a god. You know, the three things: we are not all-powerful, we're not omniscient, and we're not all-knowing. Or I guess that's what omniscient is, all-knowing. We can't be everywhere all at once. But there's also another concept of godhood, and that is creation. Being able to create life. So I guess the question of this video is, what if we ended up creating life? So two things here, two pragmatic things to consider What if we create life? Like, how is that possible? One way that's possible is, of course, we create life out of nothing. Nothing being the key word, out of elements. So maybe we got a bunch of chemicals together that are non-living beings, I don't know, like hydrogen, oxygen, and a couple of amino acids. And somehow, we scientifically are able to produce a living cell. That is human beings creating life. Certainly possible. Like, I think that's possible. I guess if you're a religious person watching this, you're going to argue that is not possible because it's only God who can create life in that manner, right? Creating life like that is playing God. And you know, what makes me, this opens up a whole can of worms. Because now what do we do? If, let's consider the if. I know you want to, if you're a Christian or a Muslim or whatever, be a religious person, you want to argue that it's not going to be possible for humans to create life out of chemicals. Fine, you can believe that. That's totally up to you. I don't want to attack that belief. What I do want to do is just continue with me for this thought experiment. What if it was possible? What if we did create a living, living cell. Living cell out of chemicals. What happens then? Now, we created life, and you know, now it's not just an experiment anymore, because before, in the scientific experiments, ethical, like, it, you know, because a lot of people get angry about stem cell research because the ethical concerns. Now we're messing with life, in a way, or potential life. So, to me personally, this is a gray area now. And I always believe, you know, I believe morality and ethics to be fairly gray in a lot of places. It's not so black and white as a lot of people would like it to be. I certainly believe that. But when we create life, I think it will certainly be really gray. What do we do with this living cell? You know, doing more experiments on it will certainly raise some ethical concerns. But I wouldn't have an issue with that in particular. But let's build it up, you know. Creating life like this, just a living cell, I feel like, and to a lot of people's mind, it's okay, you know. But how, to how far do we go before we start having ethical concerns? When the cells multiply to become two cells? When the cells multiply into becoming a complex, you know, when they join together and become an animal-like being, a sentient being, and let's say somehow we're able to speed things up, to the evolution, and we figured out this tree of life, or the evolutionary tree that we figured it out, and we use that method to speed things up, and somehow we change this cell into a lizard. Now, that's when things get really hairy to me. That's when we, you know, I'm a vegan, so anything that can feel pain to me is something that we should try not to hurt as much as possible, to try not to exploit, not to hurt, not to kill, whatever. That is certainly interesting. Now there's an ethical dilemma that we have about this life that we created. We created it, but is it fair to say that you can do whatever with it as you please because you created it? That's the question I want to ask, because that's the question we come back to with religion. God created us, right, according to religion, or God's created us. And because of that, they are this amazing, beautiful, loving beings that created us with their love. And therefore, they have this concept of heaven and hell. They have the right to judge us. They have the right to place us in heaven or to place us in hell, because it's God, because God created us, because God is all-powerful, all-knowing, all that. If that's true of God, then what about us? What if we create life? Do we have the same right to treat this lizard as however we wanted to? I would argue no. I would argue ethics is still involved in this creation. We created this lizard, but it's still something that we need to treat with care and respect. And, you know, now let's go a step further. Not a lizard, because the lizard is still, you know, there's still a lot of people who are not vegans like me, who don't consider other sentient beings as high, as such a high pedigree as a vegan like I would. But let's say, let's step it up. What about a dog? What about a pig? Would it be turned into a monkey? And then, of course, the final question, would it be actually are able to create life that is like humans? Clones. There's going to be a lot of ethical concerns with that. First of all, creating clones is an ethical concern. Creating life itself is an ethical concern. Do we have the right to do that? You know, and if we do, what for what purpose? And this is where purpose of creation becomes really important. And I feel like purpose of creation is something that we don't ask about God as religious people. You know, do you, if you're a religious person, do you ever ask, why did God create me? And really question that. And the answer that religion gives, I feel like, is a really unsatisfactory one. Because apparently the purpose of your life is to glorify God. Apparently. That's the purpose of your life. That's the reason God created you. To be praised by His creation. To be loved by His creation. Let's see, if we do the same exact thing as this God does, this, what, like, okay, so let's say I'm a lonely guy. I want love in my life. There's so many, you know, I've had relationships, but they all failed. I want a wife. They all failed. And, you know, I don't want to die a single guy. But let's say that I'm this brilliant guy who figured out a way to create a human being. And I do some genetic modification, and I do enhancing, and I create this perfect wife. And I create her. Now she's my wife. Why did I create this life? Because I wanted her to be my wife. I wanted love. That is an ethical concern. The purpose of my creation, the purpose of me creating this life, was so that I have a wife. That, you know, in some ways is problematic, you know, considering just that imagined scenario. Why is it not problematic for a God who created us? Why can't we question why God created us? But of course, I mean, that's not to say if you created a person to be your wife, okay, I could see that passing. But now, this is where it gets tricky. You created this wife. Now let's imagine that wife loves you for a little bit, but ends up falling out of love with you and doesn't like you anymore. You are the wife's creator. Now what do? You marry this person, but this person that you created wants to divorce you because she doesn't like you anymore. She fell out of love. She might have found someone else that she loves because she's a living human being like yourself, even though she's a clone. She has emotions. She has her own thoughts. She has her own freedom. Now, do you allow her to do whatever she wants to divorce you and go search for her own mate and her own freedom? Ethically, that would be the right thing to do, but that would be really hard considering, you know, just considering like, but I created you to be my wife. Why are you leaving me? Don't leave me. I created you to be this way. See, this is kind of where I'm going with that. So those are the kind of questions I want us to really be thinking about, really, just about creation in general. If I feel like we would be much more skeptical if we were the ones, you know, there would be a much greater degree of scrutiny, of ethical scrutiny, if it was human beings who were creators of life. Whereas in religion, God is the creator of life, but He doesn't get anywhere near this kind of ethical scrutiny. He just is able to do whatever He wants to do with His creation, and that's considered okay. I don't understand. I can't relate to that thinking. Okay, so that's the first scenario of us creating life, right? It's already 14 minutes. Wow, I didn't think this video would get that long. I'll continue the second part in the next video. And the next part is when I'll actually start talking about life in a different sense. So I talked about if human beings were able to create life like us, a living cell, living animal, human beings, organic beings. But there is the other scenario is much more probable. Artificial intelligence. And that's what I'll talk about in the next video. Cheers.